seventh round of the GT1 World Championship saw the teams take to the Moscow Raceway. Stefan Ortelli led the wet race at the start, but he ran wide at the first corner, allowing Marcus Vingegaard to slither up the inside and move into the lead. Soon after, the McLaren was up into second place, and the Ferraris, after a poor qualifying race, were starting to fight their way through the field. The two Audis were battling each other for supremacy, but again it was the number three Ferrari that was on a charge, making up more positions on this occasion, going past the early race leader Stefan Ortelli and the qualifying race winner from earlier on. There was also an intense inter-team battle at Hexis McLaren. Alvaro Parent sliding past Fred Makovicki up the inside to move past his teammate and up into second place and set his sights on the leader. He passed the leader in the end, going up the hill, getting to the inside of Marcus Vingegaard, outbreaking him and taking the lead of the race for Hexis. At the pit stops, Fred Makovicki came in to hand over to Steph Dusseldorp, clouting the pit lane marker as he did so, and that would take the McLarens back out in second place. The two Alinkel.com Munich Motorsports Mercedes were battling hard, Thomas Jaeger and Marcus Vingegaard going side by side through the final corner, but their battling ultimately allowed the number three Ferrari through. But then there was a change for the lead. Parent had handed over to de Moustier, and Steph Dusseldorp forced his way past the number two Hexis McLaren and into the lead of the race. Francesco Castellacci was now challenging Niki Pastorelli in the Mercedes, getting up the inside on the run down into the left-hander at turn 12. Then Philippe Salaquada was right up behind Grégoire de Moustier, sent it up the inside into turn 5. There was contact between the two of them, and de Moustier was sent spinning. Only a few moments later, and Salaquada sent Niki Pastorelli spinning as well. Both Ferraris receiving penalties, but it was the race win for Fred Makovicki and Steph Dusseldorp after a brilliant drive in the rain in Moscow. The eighth round of the championship takes place at the Nürburgring, with a number of German brands in contention. They may be run by the Belgian WRT team, but Audi will be keen to impress on home soil. They returned to form somewhat last time out in Moscow Raceway after taking the win in the qualifying race thanks to Stefan Ortelli and Laurens Vanthoor. And Ortelli is confident a similar performance may be on the cards here.
Russian was good to be back on the first position. Even if it was the start of the race, it was a good one. This is a good track for the Audi. Altogether, I think we are looking to make some podium again. The competition is very high. We can still do well in the championship in terms of team championship. So all the points will count, and both cars will be chasing maximum points as possible.
BMW have a very close association with the Nürburgring, and Michael Bartels and Jelmer Berman come into this weekend still leading the Drivers' World Championship. Michael Bartels is confident that he can get the upper hand on his fellow German rivals.
Well, I think it will be a good German fight on one of the most famous trucks in the world, of course in Germany. It's not only a German driver battle, it's also a German brand battle, and I hope we are in the end in front of them.
The Ferrari 458 has shown good pace this season, but AF Corsa have been unable to quite turn it into results. A lot of that has been down to conditions. Colder conditions like we saw in Moscow seem to help the Ferrari gain pace, and with another chilly weekend in prospect here at the Nürburgring, Tony Vallander is confident they can be battling towards the front again.
We are definitely there with the others. If we are fast enough to battle for the win, I really don't know now, but I'm confident that we will have a positive weekend.
2010 French GT champion Laurent Groppi will be driving the Ford GT this weekend alongside Benjamin Larisch. Because of the long straights, Benjamin Larisch feels that it'll play into the hands of the Ford GT, and after experiencing the circuit last year in Formula 2, he's confident the team can show some decent pace this weekend.
I raced here last year in F2, so I'm happy to be in this historical track, so I'm very happy to be here. We had a good top speed on Moscow, so I think we will be good here, I think.
Lamborghini this weekend will have one car driven by Peter Cox and Stefan Rossina, and the second by Mike Parisi and Jerome Bleekemolen. Bleekemolen has a wealth of single-seater and GT racing experience, so expect the Dutchman to be strong this weekend. And his partner, Mike Parisi, has already proven his worth in GT1 this year and is looking forward to racing this weekend with the German Ryder Engineering team.
I'm very happy to come back in the World GT1 Championship with Ryder. All is new for me, the track, the car, so it's very important to give the best of myself. I have a very good teammate too, so I think that we are one of the best pair in the championship.
It was a great weekend for McLaren in Moscow, with the Hexis Racing team completing a 1-2 finish in the championship race. Fred McAvicky and Steph Dusseldorp needed that to pull themselves back into title contention, a position that they're very much in going into this weekend. And Dusseldorp thinks a shot at the title is very much a possibility.
Yeah, I think we're going to do well. I haven't got a lot of experience in GTs on this track, but I'm pretty confident we'll fight for the victory again. And we hope we score more points than Bartels and Buurman and close the gap a little bit to make it a nice finish in Donington.
Mercedes-Benz are another German brand still in with a chance of winning the driver's title. They're currently leading the team's championship. And Marcus Winkelhock has a great amount of experience here at the Nürburgring, including leading a race in Formula One back in a rain-affected 2007 European Grand Prix. And he's hoping to put that experience to the test.
I think it's getting now really close for the championship, Mark and me. We are really giving everything. For us, it's really important to score as many points as possible, but I don't put any pressure on myself. I just drive like always, and then I hope that it ends up good.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the Nürburgring. It's the penultimate round of the 2012 FIA GT1 World Championship, and things are just starting to get tight. We're getting towards crunch time in this season, and what better place to do it than at one of the most famous racetracks in the world, the Nürburgring, with the Nordschleife alongside it. The track temperature is now 20 degrees centigrade, which is the equal hottest that it's been all day. It's been a fairly chilly weekend so far here at the Nürburgring, which has affected some of the cars, which we'll move on to talk about later on, that you can see down at the first corner. Ominous rain clouds overhead, though. We haven't had any rain today, a few light sprinklings here and there, but in general, it has remained dry. Here's a look at the Nürburgring circuit. It's the same one used by Formula One, except for the chicane at the end. We're using the faster left-right chicane, whereas they go down to the very, very slow left-right chicane. You'll see more of that once the race gets underway. So this 5.137-kilometre long circuit with 15 corners is sure to challenge the drivers. My name is Jack Nichols. We've got Hayley Coxon down in the pit lane, and this is a look at how the GT3 classifications stand at the moment. Dominic Baumann and Maximilian Boot could wrap up the title today if they are successful in finishing on the podium, but the main event is the FIA GT1 World Championship, and that's where we've got Michael Bartels and Jelmer Buurman leading the championship, 6 points clear of Marc Basseng and Marcus Winkelhock, but those two pairs start 10th and 8th on the grid respectively, and it's the third place pairing of Steph Dusseldorp and Fred McAvicky who start on pole position for this race. So the championship is all set to concertina up this weekend. Al Inkle topped the team's championship, 207 points. They've got a fairly comfortable margin now. They can afford to just consolidate now to take the victory ahead of next weekend's season finale. So let's chat with our championship leaders, but they're starting 10th place on the grid. Jelmer Buurman with Hayley Coxon.
Jelmer, it certainly wasn't the qualifying session you hoped for. What do you need to do to make up for it?
Well, about overtake 9 cars. No, I mean, it's an important race. Every point is very important, especially for the championship, obviously. And I mean, today is important, but tomorrow is, you know, there will be much more points. So I hope to, you know, get to the front a bit, hopefully top 5. And the best would be, ideally, would be podium, of course. But I mean, top 5, I would be happy. And then hopefully, you know, have a good start tomorrow, a good race, and then see where we can get.
Thank you.
So Michael Bartels, Jelmer Buurman's teammate, will be starting the number 18 Vita for One Racing Team car. And there you can see the BMW Z4, 10th place on the grid for them as the guests start to leave the grid. Very busy grid here at the Nürburgring, as you'd expect with so many German teams, drivers and brands. It really is a fantastic spectacle this weekend. And you'll see on the back of the GT1 grid is, as I mentioned before, just like in Moscow, the GT3 European Championship grid. And as I said, that title can be decided today, but we'll keep you up to date with that as we go. Car number 24 is going to be started by Jerome Bleekemolen. Him and Mike Parisi, new to the Lamborghini this weekend, but they still managed to qualify in sixth place, which Mike Parisi was a little bit disappointed with. Ultimately, he felt he could have done better, but considering it was his first time in the car and on this circuit, it was a pretty decent effort. I thought Jerome Bleekemolen has some decent experience here. In 2001, he finished runner-up in an FIA GT race here. He then went on to finish runner-up in the whole championship as well. So let's hear from the front row sitting Belgian Audi WRT team, Audi R8 LMS. Laurens Van Thor and Stefano Telli are down on the front row of the grid. And, well, we won't hear them for them just now, I'm afraid, because by the looks of it, it looks like the cars are about to set off. So it's best not to get involved. And so we will have to just watch and see how Stefano Telli and Laurens Van Thor fare. You can see on the left-hand side the pole-sitting car of Fred Makovicki and Stef Dusseldorp. On the right-hand side, the Belgian Audi WRT of Van Thor and Ortelli. Then we've got Thomas Jaeger and Nicky Passarelli. Thomas Jaeger is going to be starting that car in fourth place on the grid. And it was a really impressive lap from Jaeger because the Mercedes was struggling an awful lot, but Jaeger managed to pull it out of the bag somewhere. And as a result, they will be starting on fourth position on the grid, which is an impressive performance from them. Well, it was Pastorelli actually who set the qualifying lap, but it was Jaeger who set the impressive lap to even get them into the top eight. There you can see the leading car, the Mercedes SLS. There's third on the grid. Frank Stippler starting that car after Oliver Jarvis had guided it into the top three. So it's Audi second and third at their home circuit. It's a Belgian team that run the car, but very much a German brand, are Audi. And there's the sister car on the front row of the grid, Stefano Telli at the wheel. He led the race in Moscow, the championship race, after he won the qualifying race, but made a mistake at the very first corner, running wide and allowing the Mercedes and subsequently the two McLarens to come through past him. He'll be hoping for a little bit of a better performance here today. And can the Audis finally consolidate their pace? Apart from Nagaro, their pace has always come on weekends where the weather has been poor. And as a result, things have conspired against them. But there's the man starting on pole position, Stef Dusseldorp. It doesn't look like he really fits into that McLaren, does he? He's a very tall young man, is Stef. And he was very quick in his qualifying segment. It was Fred Makovicki, though, who took pole position. But Steph's got a reasonable amount of experience here in Formula 3. He did 2 years in the German Formula 3 Cup. He also raced here in Formula Renault 2 litre back in the 2007 and 2008 season. GT1 didn't visit this venue last year when he was racing with Hexis AMR, but nevertheless, he appears to have adapted to the circuit in this McLaren MP412C very quickly indeed. Also watch out for Alvaro Parent. You can see just there the second McLaren at the back of the screen. He's going to be one to watch coming through the field indeed, because I think he may well be able to hoist himself up the field a few places. Peter Cox and Stefan Racina are also going to be a danger. We've got a really strong front end of the grid, actually. It's very difficult to call. I would say anyone from first really down to Alvaro Parent in seventh place could be challenging for the race win. At Al Inkel, Mark Basseng and Marcus Vinkelhock struggled in qualifying. Vinkelhock managed to pull it out the bag in the end, but it was a real challenge for them. So what kind of race pace they'll have, we just don't know. The temperature has come up a little bit, and also qualifying, you need the tyres to perform quickly at their best, whereas in the race we may see the Mercedes coming on strong towards the end of the 1 hour race. Green flag waved, so the green flag lap begins behind the leading car, and it's the McLaren, then the two Audis, and we've got Thomas Jaeger, then the two Lamborghinis. It's great to see them so far forward. They've had pace so far this season, but it's never really quite come off for them. And then in the Ford GT, you can see at the back of the GT1 grid, that is going to be started by Laurent Groppi, the 2010 French GT champion, making his GT1 debut this weekend. He and Benjamin Larish in that Ford GT. And then you've got the front of the GT3 grid, which will be headed by Maximilian Buch and Dominic Baumann. But here's a look at the grid. Makovicki and Dusseldorp on pole position then. You've got Stippler and Jaeger on the second row of the grid. Third row of the grid, the two Lamborghinis, Stefan Rosina and Jerome Bleekemolen. Fourth row of the grid is Alvaro Parent and Marcus Winkelhock. Francesco Castellacci and Michael Bartels in 9th and 10th. 11th and 12th for Salacquada and Nicky Mayer-Malnoff after he made a mistake during the qualifying session. Laurent Groppi starting in 13th place on the GT1 grid. Also, watch out for those Ferraris, actually, because they were quick. They should have been quick, but for one reason or another, it was a very tight battle to get through to the final top eight shootout, and they just couldn't quite manage it after Tony Villander had gone quickest of anyone in the opening segment of qualifying. So that's definitely going to be one to watch out for as well. This is the run down into turn eight. The hairpin that looks very wide on this camera angle, but when you're actually out there on the circuit, it's a lot narrower than it looks. Then up through the very fast Schumacher S at turns 9 and 10. So this could be a really, really fun race because the Ferraris are going to be coming through the field. There's Marc Passeng on the right, Nicky Pastorelli next to him in the 38 and 37 cars respectively, watching how their teammates are about to perform here. Al Inkel, a German team. Vitafor One, a German team. We've got an onboard camera with Marcus Winkelhock. Chatting to Philippe Dumas in the qualifying session, and he was a very cheeky Frenchman, actually. He was very keen to get the upper hand on the Germans with a British car and a French team. That was looked like something that would please him immensely. And at the moment, it looks like it's something that could well happen. Because Fred Makovicki was very, very fast in the qualifying session. So a one-hour race after 25 minutes. The pit stop window will open. The drivers will come in, hand over to their teammate, change tyres, head back out for the remaining part of the race. The pit lane window will be open for 10 minutes, between 25 and 35 minutes into the race. Apart from that, it's a race to the flag. And it's going to be McLaren versus Audi. There's Philippe Dudonnet in the background, watching on as his Audis do battle for the race victory. The penultimate qualifying race of the year is about to get underway here at the Nürburgring. Steph Dusseldorp versus Stefan Ortelli on the front row of the grid. As we wait for the lights, they're underneath the BMW bridge. They go out. Well, they don't go out, in fact. There's going to be a new formation lap. So, yep, the amber lights were flashing on the bridge. So there will be another formation lap. And then the race will get underway. Not 100% sure why that may be, because it all looked to be in a nice, orderly fashion as they came through there. But I spotted the amber lights flashing because I could see the lights out of my commentary box window. So after that anticlimactic start, we'll have another go. We had two safety car starts last time out in Moscow, so at least this will be a little more exciting. There you can see the red lights, the two lights that aren't lit up to the right-hand side are the amber lights, and they were flashing as the cars came through. But the red lights are on and ready to go. I got confused for a moment because the clock started counting down. The timing clock still is counting down, but I think that will be reset in a moment for when this race gets underway properly. There's the GT3 field. Basically, if Maximilian Buch and Dominic Baumann in the silver 101 Heiko Gravity Cherus Mercedes SLS, if they finish on the podium in their particular class, then they will be crowned the 2012 GT3 European champions. Really, they took pole position for this race by 1.4 seconds, so it would be a huge shock if they didn't manage to secure a podium. Lap to wait and see and how the race transpires, though. So Steph Dusseldorp is now the leading car, effectively. And it's his job to control the pace. In that Hexis McLaren. They took a 1-2 last time out at Moscow Raceway, which was their second championship race win of the season. Only McLaren and BMW have had two championship race wins this season. There's Hans Reiter of Reiter Engineering, watching how he's got plenty of support in there, hasn't he? Watching how his teams get on. Reiter and Blancpain, obviously, with a very close association, and Blancpain a big part of both this championship and the Blancpain Endurance Series. So through the final corners we come, and we're going to have another go now then. Steph Dusseldorp and Stefano Telli on the front row, Frank Stippler and Thomas Jaeger on the second row. We wait for the lights to go out. When we do, this qualifying race will be underway. The lights go green, and it's a great start from the number 32 Audi. Stefano Telli moving into the lead, but whether he'd made a bit of a jump start is difficult to tell. Look at this field of cars on the run down into turn one. But the McLaren holds the lead. It's still in grid order at the moment. That's going to be a very, very tight squeeze through there. We go on board with Marcus Winkelhock as he tries to thread his way past a few cars. He's managed to get past one of the Lamborghinis, I think. He's also got his teammate Thomas Jaeger on his inside. No, both the Lamborghinis are still out there. Then we've got Alvaro Perez trying to stick it around the outside. The two Audis are battling with each other as well. But at the moment, and look at that, the two Mercedes going side by side, and that allows one of the BMWs to come through. Presumably Michael Bartels it is, who's the furthest forward of the BMs. Yes, it is, as they drop down now into five and six. But it's still McLaren leading. Ahead of the two Audis, ahead of the two Lamborghinis, but this German brand battle is kicking off already with Alvaro Parent getting involved as well. Down towards turn eight. Marcus Vingelock has managed then to get himself up into seventh place. Bartels has gone from 10th to 8th as we go on board now with the Mercedes, looking back at Michael Bartels through the Schumacher S. A little lift and then back on the power. And that's a spin and into the wall. What an unfortunate start to your own Bleeker Molens GT1 career. He's out of the race on the exit of the Schumacher S. And that may well bring out the safety car as well. But meanwhile, the McLaren is breaking clear. A little bit of a run wide from Alvaro Parent as he battles hard. The Ford GT is doing all right as well. There's Hans Reiter. Doesn't really know what to say because that's the second time we've seen a Reiter Engineering Lamborghini in the wall this season after Albert Montoya Taxis had an accident and the safety car is deployed. Good to see your own Bleeker Molen out, but the safety car has been deployed here at the Nürburgring. That may well be the first in-race crash for a GT1 car we've had this season. Driving standards this year have been absolutely exemplary. Last season, there have been a few incidents here and there, but so far this year, it's been very, very impressive driving. It was difficult to make out exactly what happened to your own. We just saw it at the far reaches of the angle that we saw, and unfortunately, he is out of the race. There's no doubt about that. And yep, that's out of the Schumacher S, isn't it, that he's gone off. So the safety car deployed. Dusseldorp leads, Ortelli second, Stippler third, Rossina fourth, Winkelhock fifth, Bartels sixth, Parent seventh, Jaeger eighth. And then it's Groppi in ninth with 10th place Francesco Castellacci. And then we've got the GT3 field behind, headed by Maximilian Buch, then David Mengsdorf and Stefano Guy, the top three in GT3. So as they come down into the hairpin at turn eight, hopefully your own Bleeker Molens car will be removed fairly quickly. But what a shame that is for he and Mike Parisi as well. Car 150 has gone off as well at turn 11 apparently, which is the very next corner. So that is Giuseppe Ciro, Gaetano Adagna Perez starting that car. So we'll keep an eye out for that. I wonder if he and Bleeker Molen came together potentially, and that's where the damage happened. Bleeker Molen's car is in the wall just here on the right hand side, but then where that camera is, just to the left of this shot now, there may be an Air Force of Ferrari off somewhere, but we'll have to wait and see. Hopefully we won't need barrier repairs. If you were watching the qualifying session earlier on, you'll have seen a good hour or so of barrier repairs, and I'm not up for any more of that really. But there is Mike Parisi on the left hand side, Hans Reiter with the thumbs down, very disappointed with such a abrupt end to the race for his 24 car. They've still got Stefan Rosina and Peter Cox in the race. Stefan Rosina in fourth place, not too far off the back of Frank Stippler when the safety car came out. And then Marcus Vigelhoek's done a great job to find himself up into fifth position. Here's a look at the replay. We only see it from there. I don't think that's too heavy an impact, hopefully. I mean, it is with the tyres, and it has done a reasonable amount of damage to the front end, no doubt about that. But it should be, by the looks of it, not a write-off and something that they can get to grips with and deal with overnight. As we see the GT3 Audi R8, it's the 117 Team Nova driver car of Natalia Fradina starting this race. She's currently running at the back of the GT3 field. So the two Audis will be happy they managed to maintain position. It was very busy going down into turn one. I was very impressed we didn't have, well, there were hardly any signs of contact at all going down into the first corner, which was great to see. No real changes of position either. Rotelli seemed to... you know, I wonder if Stefano Rotelli came off the throttle a little bit, because when the lights went out, he was a long way ahead of Steph Dusseldorp. So I wonder if he kind of self-adjudicated himself and thought, oh dear, I think I might have jumped the start there, I'll back off, because he was such a long way ahead that then Steph Dusseldorp cruised past him on the run down into turn one. So I wonder if... that was a bit of clever work from Ortelli to back off. There's Fred Makovicki. He'll be taking over the number one car when it comes in for its mandatory pit stop in the next 15 minutes. And the 15 minutes the pit stop window will open. But the light's still on the safety car. If the lights do go off on the safety car, it will have happened by the time they get up to the chicane down the long back straight. The lights are still on, unfortunately, after we had a bit of a controversy with the safety car at the Slovakia Ring last time when it came in to give us a lap of racing, and the decision was quite late, but I knew it was coming in. The Alinkol team knew it was coming in, but the Vitova One team either didn't spot it or didn't manage to get their message to their driver in time, and as a result Matthias Lauda was caught out and overtaken by Marcus Vigelhoek. Four laps completed now. So, your own Bleeker Molen out of the race. Let's hear from the head of Reiter Engineering, Hans Reiter.
Once again for the number 24 car, Hans. What happened? We can't quite work it out.
Well, the only thing we know, or I know from radio, is that Jerome said, sorry guys. So I guess it was his mistake, and yeah, it's a pity. Currently we are consuming more cars per race than tires, and really we'll have to build a few cars now because we're running out of cars.
Is the car going to be okay? Do you know the extent of the damage?
No, I don't think so. It looked like a heavy shunt, not as heavy at Albert since the last race, but it looked like a serious one. So I get front chassis, rear chassis. I would be surprised if it would be repairable, but let's hope.
Thank you.
Shows what I know, doesn't it? I said it looked repairable to me, but Hans Reiter probably knows a little bit more about his cars than I do. Down into turn 8, come the field behind the safety car. Vitelli just slowing them up a little bit, you can see there, just to give himself quite a lot of breathing space actually between the McLaren in front of him. Hopefully he won't get into trouble before that, because there are regulations that state exactly how far you must stay behind the car in front during a safety car period. Hopefully the stewards will not decide that that's a punishable situation. Out of the Schumacher S, and you can see Jeroen Bleekemolen's car appears to have been cleared from the left-hand side of the picture there. But the lights are still on the safety car. We've still got that mystery 150 car of Gaetano Ardanghna Perez. Nowhere to be seen. Off at turn 11 according to the timing screen. So we're still yet to exactly figure out where that is or what happened to Gaetano. But that makes the job of that effectively actually puts them out of running for the GT3 European Championship. It means that Mengsdorf and Procek are the only people now that can catch Dominic Baumann and Maximilian Buch. So it's all down to the Lamborghini. Safety car comes over the start-finish line once again. Steph Dusseldorp leading the way. Had a great season last year. Seventh in the championship in his first year of GT racing. Driving with Hexis when they were in their Aston Martin. Won at Abu Dhabi. As I say, he's also won this year at the Navarra circuit and at Moscow. Strong Formula 3 record as well before he made the move to GT cars in 2011. Francesco Castellacci running in 10th place. So 10th and 11th for Ferrari. Again, oh, there you can see, just at the bottom of the screen there, there is the 150 Ferrari of Gaetano Ardanghna Perez. So we found the missing air, of course, of Ferrari, and that means it is out of the running for the GT3 European Championship of 2012. So Ardanghna Perez and Giuseppe Ciro won't be the champions this year. Message has come up that the start was okay and no further action will be taken. So that's obviously been investigated, whether they were investigating everyone or whether they were investigating that potential Ortelli infringement. They've decided that no further action is to be taken over the start, so it's good to see. Yeah, the Ferrari's down in 10th and 11th, and we went to talk to Tony Volander yesterday, I think it was. And he was like, oh, do you want to talk about the car that's fast but never wins? And that seems to be the way that the Ferrari season has gone. They've got good drivers in there. Francesco Castellacci is the reigning GT3 European champion. Sala Quadra has lots of single-seater experience in Formula 3 Euro Series, German F3, Formula BMW, A1 GP. He's had two pole positions in Formula Renault 3.5 as Philippe Sala Quadra. Tony Volander was strong in Italian F3. He's raced in GP2. He's won Italian GT championships. He's a factory Ferrari endurance driver. So they struggle to figure out at Ferrari just why things haven't come together for them, because they've had the pace in the car all season. Since the opening qualifying session in Nagaro, where Volander took pole position, they've had the pace. But only one championship race podium for them this year, which was at the second race in Zolder. Since then, it's been a lot more difficult for them. They haven't finished in the top four since the first round in Slovakia. They haven't finished in the top six since the first round of Slovakia. So it really has been difficult for them. So how does this look as far as the championship is concerned? It's going to play into the hands of Steph Dusseldorp and Fred Makovicki, but there aren't that many points on offer today. It's 8 for the win, 6 for second. So if things were to stay how they are now, I know we've only had one lap of proper racing, but if things were to stay how they are now, then Dusseldorp and Makovicki would close in by 7 points on Bartels and Berman. So that would give... That would then mean our top three in the championship would be separated by just 10 points. Going going into the final, the penultimate championship race of the season, which is quite an exciting prospect, actually. So, we're still under safety car conditions here because of this spin from Jeroen Bleekemolen. Oh, has he dropped it by himself? Well, that is a surprise, isn't it? I have to say, Jeroen Bleekemolen just running wide at the end of the Schumacher S's. And that's going to be a very disappointing walk back to the paddock for Jeroen. Peter Cox watching on. His teammate is fine and still there in fourth place. But that is a real shame for that to happen. Safety car still out here. And it's going to stay out for another lap. Presumably then, it looked like to me that he just hit the tyre wall and didn't actually collect the Armco barrier when we saw that replay, but perhaps there was some Armco barrier damage done down there because we're still under safety car conditions. So now we're about to there's suggestions here that Bleekemolen picks up a left rear puncture. He gets some opposite lock on, but you can see the black tyre marks actually where the back end has stepped out. I would suggest that he's just lost it, frankly, because you can see clear two black tyre marks going sideways out of the Schumacher S's. Let's see if he collects the Armco barrier or anything. Unfortunately, we were following the sister Lamborghini at the time, but potentially something went wrong with the car on the exit of the corner. But yeah, he has collected the Armco a little bit. Hans Reiter. Well, there you can see the wreckage of the 24 car. Safety car will be in this lap. So that's very good news. You can take those boards in a minute, chaps. Because the safety car will be in at the end of this lap and we will finally get racing underway here at the Nürburgring. It's been a day of delays so far. We had an hour or so wait while they rebuilt Armco this morning. We've lost the first 20 minutes of this race behind the safety car after losing the first start behind, well, for some reason this first start was aborted. Finally, we're about to get some action here at the Nürburgring. Bring in an old pair of hands like Jeroen Bleekemolen, an experienced pair of hands. It has to be a disappointment when something like that happens. Jeroen will be as disappointed as anyone. Hopefully Reiter can get the car sorted for tomorrow or bring another car up as they managed from Slovakia. So the safety car in this lap. Watch for the Ferraris. They need to carve their way through the field if they want to salvage anything from this weekend. Is Stef Dusseldorp going to bolt? Is Stefan Ortelli going to use his experience to be right with Dusseldorp and challenge for the lead? Is Marcus Vinkelhock in that Mercedes going to become a bit of a moving roadblock potentially? Are the two Audis going to engage in a battle? And watch out for Alvaro Parent as well in the second Hexas McLaren. We've got a lot of stories going on here. Also watch out for that first GT3 Mercedes. You can tell the GT3 cars because they've got the black numbers, the white numbers on the black background on the side. There you see 104. So watch out also for the 101 Mercedes, because if that car finishes in the top three of GT3, then it will be the champion of the season. 40 minutes to go. The safety car peels into the pit lane and Stef Dusseldorp has gone already. Great restart from the Dutchman. Stefan Ortelli couldn't stay with him. Alvaro Parent's got a decent restart, actually. He's right up behind Michael Bartels as they come across the line. Also involved is Thomas Jaeger in that battle. But Dusseldorp leads. Ortelli second. Stippler thinking about a move in third place. Will Parent send one up the inside into turn one? He's feeling brave. Is he going to get that car stopped in time? Yes, he is. Good move from Parent. Bartels tries to hang it on around the outside, but Parent runs him out of room. Brilliant stuff from the Portuguese driver. And he now moves up into sixth position. And the Mercedes could be following through before too long. Into turn two, right up behind Bartels. And then behind we've got Groppi, who looks like he's starting to come under pressure from the Ferraris. But look at that, Dusseldorp has made an excellent safety car restart. Is Groppi about to get passed by one of the Ferraris? No. Castellaggi looked to the inside, but couldn't find the gap. There is Castellacci and Salaquada running in 10th and 11th places. And they've got the first of the GT3 cars, and is that a front right puncture for the race leader? Steff Dusseldorp locking up big time, going down into the right hander, and it is! The Hex's McLaren lead car has picked up a front right puncture, I think. And as a result, Steff Dusseldorp is going to drop so far back, almost collects his teammate Alvaro Perez, and he's blocked off his teammate, and that allows the BMW and the Mercedes through. What drama here! It's now an Audi 1-2 at the lead of this race. Incredible stuff. And Steff Dusseldorp and Fred McAvicky were my money for the win here, but they have dropped right off the pace now with that front right puncture. Even if Dusseldorp manages to coax it back to the pits, he is not going to be able to climb back up into a decent point scoring or decent finishing position for the race tomorrow, and he hasn't. He's parked it. What disappointment. Look at this, how Alvaro Parent didn't know which way to go. And as a result, the BMW and the Mercedes dive through on the inside. So Parent's got to do all that overtaking again. The Hex's team can't believe it, but across the line come the Belgian WRT Audi pairing. Stefano Ortelli leading, Frank Stippler in second place. Good battle going on here with the 111 car of David Mengsdorf. He's battling with the 151 car of Stefano Guy. This is a battle in GT3. Guy sending it to the outside, unable to get past Mengsdorf, but it's still Maximilian Buch leading that race. But leading the GT1 race is now Stefano Ortelli. Frank Stippler in second. Stefan Rossina promoted to third place then because of that. And look at that, Marcus Winkelhock staying with them. Marcus Winkelhock in fourth place is still right in there, and that has really damaged McAvicky and Dusseldorp's championship chances, because they're going to have to start from 13th on the grid tomorrow. So it really is going to be a challenge for them to come from 13th through to win, because a win is really what they need. But now let's focus on this race. The pit stop window actually opens in a minute. Such has been the safety car period we've had. As we come up into the Schumacher S, I'm impressed with Winkelhock staying with these guys. So let's hear from the Hexis Racing team principal, Philippe Dumas. He's with Hayley Coxham.
Philippe, can you update us on what's happening?
We have a technical problem, probably a wishbone or upright, I don't know. I'm so disappointed. Shit.
Thank you. Excuse me for the swearing.
Yeah, apologies for that. Philippe Dumas, clearly a very disappointed man. And it's interesting that he thinks it's a technical problem, because it looked initially, didn't it, like a puncture. But then as he went up the hill towards the Schumacher S's, the tyre didn't look particularly deflated. So it's an interesting one. So it looked like it was more a suspension or wishbone problem, as Philippe Dumas says. Down towards turn one then. The lead four have broken clear of Michael Bartels, now in fifth place. The lights flashing on Thomas Jaeger's car. He qualified in fourth place, don't forget, Thomas Jaeger, and to now find himself in sixth place, he would have been seventh after the shuffle at the end of the first lap. So he's now very much in the mood to get back past Michael Bartels. Vita Verwon versus Al Inkel, as we've seen so many times this season, with Hexes lurking in the background as well. Thomas Jaeger, a bit of a specialist around the Nordschleifer and the Nürburgring. Michael Bartels, of course, no stranger to it either. Brilliant to see these two Germans going head-to-head. Look at the speed that Alvaro Parent's got. Jaeger having to go a little bit defensive because Parent is really on it. They come down into turn eight. Up into the Schumacher S, and Parent is tucked right into the slipstream of Jaeger. The Mercedes is quick, though, through that fast corner, isn't it? We saw in Portimao at the final corner, the Mercedes was particularly strong through the faster stuff. But there's our two race leaders. But look at that. Winkelhock is really closing in now on Stefan Rossina. He's starting to put him under a lot of pressure. Then we've got this little gap back to Winkelhock, Bartels and Jaeger. It's a 3-second gap back to this battle now. The pit stop window is open. So it'll be interesting to see if we... Well, here's the look at the replay, actually. it looked from here like it was just a kind of a puncture, but then when we see the car go up the hill, the camera zooms in, and then, oh, we've got pitting already. This is Michael Bartels and Thomas Jaeger both coming into the pits. Now, it surprised me that Jaeger has come in, because he's been very, very quick. So this is going to be, as we've had a couple of times again this season, Al Inkle versus Vita for one in the pit stops. Hjalmar Berman has been on it in the BMW this season. He's been on it this weekend as well. There you can see Al Inkle at the near side. Vita for one behind. Driver change is done. Final wheel change now to do. And where the car's not going anywhere. Berman is revving it, but he couldn't get it away. And as a result, the Mercedes is in front of the BMW now. Nicky Pastorelli in front of Hjalmar Berman. What happened down there at Vita for one? They seemed to get the pit stop done in time, but then they just couldn't. Hjalmar Berman couldn't get the car away. We've seen that happen a couple of times with Nicky Mayer-Melnoff and Matthias Lauda in the 17 car, but so far the 18 car's pit stops this season have been, on the most part, very strong. Here's the battle for third place still going on then. It's Stefan Rosina in 25, Marcus Vinkelhock behind in the 38 Mercedes, but here are the two Audis leading the way. We haven't really mentioned much of them, but Stefano Telli and Frank Stippler out in first and second. In comes Stippler then to hand over to Oliver Jarvis. Audi's pit stops have tended to be a fraction slower than some of their rivals. They've especially struggled with their wheel nuts. Look at Alvaro Parent closing in. I bet, has he done the fastest lap of any of them on this last lap? No, he hasn't. Ortelli's done a quick lap as well, but he was 8 tenths of a second quicker than these two in front. So Alvaro Parent is going to be in this battle before too long. Into the pits comes Stippler, and into the car gets Oliver Jarvis. Oh, and there's a fall. That won't cost them too much time, I don't think, because the tyre man wasn't there. Now, the interesting thing is going to be where they come out in relation to Pastorelli and Berman. That's going to be the interesting thing, because you can see trouble at the left rear, and they're going to get leapfrogged by Pastorelli and Berman. There's almost no doubt about that. Away goes the Audi, but there was some real trouble on the left rear of that car. Down the start-finish straight they come. Surely the Audi isn't going to make it out of the pits in time. It's not. And from such a good position, Oliver Jarvis now finds himself, ultimately, that'll probably shake out to being something like 6th or 7th place. Mayer-Melnoff has come in as well to hand over to Matthias Lauda in the 17 Vita for 1 Racing Team BMW. But now we've got Berman versus Pastorelli, which is ultimately, I think, going to be for 4th position now. Berman getting great drive out of turn 4. There's our race leader, Stefan Ortelli. He's going to come in to hand over to Laurens Vanthoor. Rosina will come in and hand over to Peter Cox. Vinkelhock will come in and hand over to Mark Bassett. Here we go then, Hjalmar Berman versus Pastorelli. Wonder if Berman will fancy a look into the hairpin. He's not going to be quite close enough this time, is he? But BMW is looking much quicker than the Mercedes at this point in time. Really, they probably don't want to battle each other too much, because the time they'll lose, as we saw in Portimao earlier this year, will cost them, and they'll get closed in on. Or I guess they were behind, so they'll lose time to the rivals up at the front of the field. But Telly's staying out for the time being, I think, the race leader, as we continue to watch this battle. Now the BMW struggles in straight line speed in general, and so you can see Hjalmar Berman not quite closing in enough. He shows his nose towards the inside, but through this quick left right there's not going to be enough room for him. In comes Vinkelhock then to hand over to Mark Basseng, who gets a good getaway. He was in front of these two anyway, so that's no real shock to see him emerge in front. They might have closed in a little bit though, you know, Pastorelli and Berman. Surely this will be the move now from Berman. He's right up behind. He's just got to send it in late on the brakes. It's going to be his only chance because the BMW isn't very strong in a straight line. So if he wants to get past, I think it's just got to be on the brakes. Unless he can sneak away past through some of this tighter infield stuff where the Mercedes is weak. Hear that the BMW and the Mercedes, two of the best sounding cars out there, so it's great to hear them coming on the power on the exit of four. There's our race leader though, Stefano Telli. Into the pits he comes. Will Rossina follow him in, or will he stay out and lead a lap? I think he has come into the pits as well. Yes, he has, but this battle continues. Oh, that's wide from Pastorelli. Is that going to allow Berman the chance to get up the inside? No. There's two lines you can take through that hairpin. You can either hug it all the way around or kind of dip out midway through the corner to then get a nice late apex and a run up the hill. But Pastorelli is pushing that car hard, having a few corrections of it through the Schumacher S's. We've already seen what can happen in the Schumacher S's if you get it wrong. There's Ortelli handing over to Laurens Vanthoor. Now, can WRT have a slicker pit stop this time around? That looked all right. That looked all right for Laurens Vanthoor. Into the final corner comes Pagan. And look at that! They've jammed them at the pit stops. The Lamborghini leads. Peter Cox comes out in the lead of the race. They have managed to jump the WRT team at the pit stops. And so the 25 Reiter Engineering Lamborghini leads here at the Nürburgring. Still, Jelmer Berman can't find a way past. But now, well, it's not a given lead just yet, because we've still got Alvaro Parent to consider. He's going to do one more lap, and the Hexis team are very slick at their pit stops. Stefan Rossina pretty happy with that, as you'd imagine. But we've still, as I say, got to watch out for Alvaro Parent in the number two McLaren. He's going to be the man to watch in these final windows of pit stops. But there is Peter Cox, the Dutchman, who's had two fastest laps of the race in two events so far this season, but yet to make it onto the podium, incredibly. Berman can't do anything about Pastorelli. Here comes Alvaro Parent then into the pit lane, and this is going to decide who is going to be leading the race at the end of the pit stop window. It hardly feels like we had any racing before the pit stop window happened, does it? Because we had so long behind the safety car. Berman all over the back of that Mercedes. But there's just nothing he can do about it. He's got to be clever somehow. There's our race leader though, Peter Cox. He's pulled away as well because he came out of the pits just in front of Laurens Vanthoor. But now he's got a comfortable margin. Here comes the pit stop. Alvaro Parent jogs away. Grégoire de Moustier takes over. Out of the final corner, or into the final corner, I should say. Turn 17 comes Peter Cox. Away goes de Moustier. Lighting up the rear tyres. Has that cost him time? This is going to be close, but I think the Lamborghini's going to get it. Peter Cox moves into the lead of the race. Grégoire de Moustier will slot into second place then. How quickly can he get his McLaren's tyres up to temperature before he comes under attack from Laurens Vanthoor and Marc Basseng? I don't understand where the pace has come from the Mercedes, because all of a sudden they're genuine front runners. Jelmer Berman, we saw in the background, almost looked like he'd found a way past, and there comes Basseng attacking now. Laurens Vanthoor. Berman didn't find a way past. De Moustier gets it wrong on the exit of four. We go on board with Basseng. Vanthoor up into second place. Basseng up into third place. De Moustier just getting it sideways on the exit of turn four, I think, on the cold tyres. And that's Laurens Vanthoor in front of us then in second position. The speck in the distance you can see is Peter Cox. He has bolted. How brilliant it would be to see the Lamborghinis take a win, albeit a qualifying race win. And Jelmer Berman must be the most frustrated man in Germany right now. There's nothing he can do to get around Nicky Pastorelli. And now Pastorelli's kind of getting into the groove a little bit. He's not under as much pressure. And they'll be closing in on Grégoire de Moustier before too long, unless de Moustier can get his tyres up to temperature quickly. 23 minutes of the race remaining here at the Nürburgring. Can Berman find a way past, perhaps in the battle with Grégoire de Moustier that may unfold? That might be Berman's opportunity. But de Moustier is holding his own quite well, actually, in this opening outlap. Now, that could be crucial. Pastorelli, a half-hearted manoeuvre up the inside into the final corner. Is that going to be just the run that Hjalmar Berman needs? There's about a car length between them as they come past my commentary box window. But Berman's not going to be quite close enough still. Into turn two, you see de Moustier taking a different line through there, a wider line in. A more classic racing line, but in general, it seems to be a narrower line that the drivers take through the second corner. Moustier, no such troubles that time through turn four. Tony Vallander has just set the fastest final sector of anyone in his Ferrari. So who have we got that can join this battle? Oliver Jarvis is 14 seconds back in the 33 Audi. I know they had trouble in the pit stops, but they didn't have... Oh, sorry, they're 7.5 seconds back. My apologies. They're 14 seconds behind the leader, so that probably makes sense with that mistake in the pit stops. So there we saw our top six all come through. Peter Cox leading. Lawrence Vanthoor on that last lap was a second slower than Peter Cox. Fantastic stuff from Peter Cox out the front. Hugely experienced racer. And he's finally getting to show us up at the front why he is so hugely experienced and why he has won so many championships and races around the world. He's the quickest man on the circuit, except for Oliver Jarvis, who is lapping a couple of tenths of a second quicker. Into the final corner, Berman goes for the move. Well, goes for the nose up the inside anyway. Pastorelli had to come across late in the day to get the cover done. Parent lapping a couple of tenths of a second slower than Marc Basseng in front of him. But at the moment, you have to say de Moustier... De Moustier. He is holding his own. It's not as though the Mercedes is all over the back of him by any stretch of the imagination. Peter Cox on that last lap was matched by Lawrence Vanthoor. Fastest lap of the race went to Alvaro Parent, actually, on his in lap, not the actual lap he came into the pits, but the one previous to that. This is how the championship would look at the if the race were to finish now. You see Makovicki and Dusseldorf on 110 points, so that would drop them 15 points behind Winkelhock and Basseng. So that really was a shame, both for Makovicki and Dusseldorf, and I think for the championship. It's still going to be a brilliant final few rounds, but if Dusseldorf and Makovicki had won today, it would really close things up at the top. They're still not out of it by any stretch, but things have become a little harder for them. Out of turn 12 come these three, still battling over fourth place. Fastest middle sector of anyone on that last lap for Peter Cox. He may well be about to set the fastest lap of the race, Peter Cox, because this is a very impressive lap time. Comes across the line to do a 1 minute 56.663. He doesn't set the fastest lap of the race by 0.06 of a second. So a very, very quick lap from Peter Cox. Does Berman fancy it? No, he doesn't. He keeps being tempted by it, doesn't he, down into turn one. Just sending one up the inside late in the day, but there's nothing he can do. This is where the Hexis McLaren is stronger than the Mercedes behind. Peter Cox leads with 18 minutes to go. Lawrence Vanthorpe in second place. Team manager of car 17 and 18 to race control immediately. So that's Vita for One Racing Team. Their team manager, which is essentially Michael Bartels, has been sent to race control. So we've spoken to Hans Reiter once today. The first time he was sad. Second time,
Hans, it certainly wasn't the best start for the team today, but what a great race it's been for Peter Cox and Stefan Rosina.
Yes, yeah, unbelievable. It's up and down in our team, and since it was in half an hour, great. We gained position with the pit stop, so this is just a dream for the team to overtake Audi in the pits. It was great for us, and again, the race is not yet over, but at least it looks quite good and promising.
Thank you.
Second time he's happy. Again, that last lap, Peter Cox took 6 tenths of a second away from Lawrence Vanthorpe. You can see there, in fact, the lap comparison. Lap 17, they were matched, but lap 16 and 18, it was 1.6 seconds. Here comes Berman again. He's so quick out of that quick flick, chicane. And all of a sudden, Demoustier isn't being troubled up in front. Enzo Eid is running in 10th place, so let's have a look. Berman doesn't do it again. But this is our top six. We know them very well. Jarvis is behind in 7th place. Then it's Tony Verlander in 8th place, lapping very strongly, frankly. If he was up at the front of the field, if Jarvis and Verlander were up at the front, they'd be more than holding their own. Then we've got Matthias Lauder in 9th, Enzo Eid in 10th, Benjamin Larisch in 11th. With Makovicki and Parent, Dusseldorf and Blinkmolen, out of the race, unfortunately. As far as GT3 is concerned, Dominic Baumann is now at the wheel of the 101 car, and as a result, he will be taking the GT3 European Championship title if he holds on for the next 15 minutes or so. Down into 8. Oh, that's another tantalising look up the inside for Jelmer Berman when Pastorelli goes in long. And there is Michael Bartels. He's either been to see the race director or sent someone else to see the race director. So he's watching on at the pit wall. Pastorelli will have been here already this year, actually. Earlier this season, GT Open came here. And Pastorelli competes in that sometimes. When GT1 doesn't clash, so he always already got some experience around this circuit as he comes up towards the chicane. A little look towards the inside from Jelmer Berman. Not close enough. Berman's been thinking about that look up the inside every single time, and then he checks back to the outside to try and get the run out of the corner. But the BMW straight line speed just doesn't quite allow it. He might be closer this time around, though. There's hardly anything between them as they come down into turn one. You get the feeling that every time he's just thinking about it on the brakes into one, but is never quite confident enough to hold it all the way in there. And now he's run out wide on the exit of two. Hasn't compromised him too much. But Grégoire Demoustier in front is doing a very good job now of pulling away from these two. The gap between them is up to a second. You can see Berman taking wider lines into every corner just to try and get a bit of a run out. Now down into the hairpin he comes. And we're going to see Pastorelli's deep line once more. No, he hugs the inside this time around. I guess with Berman that close behind, it's a little bit dangerous to do a deep break and give the opportunity for an overlap. Berman has been pressing Pastorelli pretty much for since the pit stop windows. And so far, Pastorelli hasn't put a foot wrong. Here they come, out towards the chicane again. You can see the BMW just edging closer over the last three laps. Fractions of a second, but he's getting closer. It's not close enough, though, with 13 minutes to go. Let's see what he does into this final corner. He's shimmied towards the inside on every lap for the past three or four, but doesn't this time around. Such a close battle, as we were anticipating. There's Oliver Jarvis now. How far behind is he? He was seven. He's still six. Here comes Berman up the inside into turn one. Finally made the move on the brakes. The Vidova One team delighted. A sigh of relief from one of the mechanics in the middle. But Hjalmar Berman has been tentatively looking at that move throughout this race. And he's finally made the move stick. And he moves up into fifth place. Let's hear from Michael Bartels, Hjalmar Berman's teammate. What's his reaction to that move?
Hjalmar certainly put the pressure on him. Finally, he took the place.
Well, I mean, you could see that he can go a little quicker than the Mercedes, but a lot of time is lost to catch up to the group in front. We need each point. We had not a good qualifying session in Q2 with me. So currently running in fifth position, our direct competitor, the Mercedes, is in third. So the last 10 minutes, we try to have to make up one more position.
Thank you.
So yeah, the question now is, can Hjalmar Berman close in on Grégoire de Moustier for fourth place? That's going to be the challenge. There's 1.4 seconds between them. There's the Ford GT, currently running in 11th position. So now, here comes Berman. We've seen a lot of him today, because he's now going to be on the back of Grégoire de Moustier. Look how quickly he's dropped Nicky Pastorelli. This is going to, if things stayed how they are right now, the gap of 6 points that is currently the case would come down to 4 points. So they're trying to minimise the damage. If the BMW can get past the Mercedes, the McLaren in front, then the gap would come down by only 1 point at the top of the championship. But then the big points are on offer in the championship race tomorrow. Through turn two, Berman surely is just going to come across the same problem with the McLaren, though, as he had with the Mercedes, and then he can get as close as he wants, but if he doesn't have the straight line speed, he won't be able to do it. De Moustier might need to go defensive here, though, into turn five. Berman got a great run out of four, and again you can see the wider line being taken by Berman. Gets on the power sooner. De Moustier, now, is he going to defend for all his life is worth, or is he going to be fairly circumspect about things? Less than 10 minutes to go here at the Nürburgring. Peter Cox continues to lead. He's got a 4.4 second advantage out of the front now. Great drive from Peter Cox. And Stefan Rosina, to be fair. Van Thor still in second place in the Audi. Has de Moustier gone a little bit wide there? I think he has. That might just give Berman the exit he needs from turn 12. He's right underneath the rear end of that McLaren now. The chicane is perhaps a little too fast a place to make the move, but if he can keep this close and perhaps repeat his manoeuvre into turn 1 that he pulled on Nicky Pastorelli a lap or two ago, he's got a great exit from the chicane, and Hjalmar Berman moves up into 4th place. The Vidova One team delighted with that one. We saw actually the BMW was very strong on the exit of that chicane against the Mercedes, and now he's up into fourth. 8 minutes to go, and 2.3 seconds to close in on Marc Basseng. That would be a fight and a half, wouldn't it? So Hjalmar Berman, a brilliant drive, as we've seen so often this season, and he's up into fourth place. There's our race leader coming through. Then we've got Lawrence Vanthor in second place. About to lap Alexei Vasiliev. Jarmer Berman made his GT1 debut at the end of last year in San Luis, where he won both races. So there is the 101 car of Dominic Baumann leading the FIA GT3 European Championship race. And if he can hold on there for the remaining 8 minutes, they will be champions this season. Him and Maximilian Buch. Down into the right-hander at turn six. It's been a brilliant season for them so far. And really, they're going to take the championship today, unless something goes wrong in the last 7.5 minutes. But up at the front of GT1, it's Peter Cox, who has been absolutely on it. Very quick in a straight line is that Lamborghini, actually. Looking at the speed traps, he's hitting 230 kilometres an hour in Sector 1. There's the championship predictions then. You'll see the gap has come down, or will come down, to 5 points. Between Bartels and Dusseldorf and Makovicki, it'll be 20 points. So that will... They'll only lose 3 points ultimately today, but there was the look of it when the safety car was out. If things had stayed how they were then, the gap would have been down to just 7 points. 10 points between first and third. Now it's looking like 20. There is Jarmer Berman. What's he done on that last lap then? He's taken a second out of Basseng in front, but to be honest, that's not enough, because with 6 minutes to go, that means we're going to get about 3 laps. There's a chance he might be on him by the very end of the race, like literally the final lap, the final few corners. There's Peter Cox, the Lamborghini Gallardo, leading not for the first time full stop, but the first time for a consistent amount of time, and being led by Peter Cox from Eindhoven in the Netherlands. Plenty of experience, plenty of racing experience. You may remember him from that 1998, 99, 2000 era of the British Touring Car Championship, where he was racing. He's won the Spa 24 Hour in 1995. He was the ADAC GT Masters champion in 2010. But it's not just recent results. He was a very strong single-seater peddler early on in his career. 1982 Dutch karting champion. Formula Open champion in 1989. Had spells in German and British Formula 3. British Formula 2 as well. Moved to GT cars and tin tops back in 93. Since then has gone on to win a lot of things. Now we're on board with Basseng. That's Berman behind us. And that last lap, Berman managed to take another 0.8 seconds out. Is Basseng losing out here? Because that's Alexei Vasiliev, I think, in front of them in the Audi. It's the Nova driver Audi of Alexei Vasiliev who's getting in the way a little bit here, and Mark Basseng won't be impressed with that one, because now he's got Jarmer Berman right on his tail with 4 minutes and 20 seconds to go. Berman gets out of shape on the exit of 4. That'll just compromise his attack a little bit, but he's still well within a second now of Mark Basseng. Basseng on the power, nice and early. Run down into 8. 4 minutes to go. Well, just under 4 minutes to go now. Berman taking that wide double apex line into the hairpin. Great view from the back of the Mercedes, as the BMW desperately tries to claw its way closer, clouting the curb. Look how much speed it took through the Schumacher S. This is the battle for third place in the race, but also It's the battle for the championship. If Berman finishes behind, they lose 1 point of their advantage. If Berman gets in front, they gain a point of their championship advantage. And as Michael Bartels says, every point counts. If you take it easy and just settle for this position, then come Donington in a week time and you lose the championship by 1 point, you're going to regret that decision. 3 minutes to go. Race leader already across the line. So this will be the penultimate lap of the race, I think. Blue flags being waved for Alexei Vasiliev. Grégoire de Moustier gets past. But is this battle over third place between the two main title protagonists now that is taking all of our attention? The Lamborghini leading the Audi by 5 seconds. Fanthor was slightly quicker on that last lap by half a second. Well, Peter Cox surely has this one in the bag. What can Jelmer Berman do? It's going to be a real challenge for him to get past Marc Basset. De Moustier in the McLaren was obviously weaker out of the chicane. And look at that gravel being kicked up by Berman. He is pushing so hard, weaving to try and get the gravel off his tyres so it doesn't affect him into the braking zone of turn 8. Up into the Schumacher S they come for the penultimate time. Berman isn't quite close enough yet to really put the pressure on Bassin. Really impressive GT driver Jelmer Berman is turning into. Out onto the back straight. It's no surprise either because he has an incredible single-seater record. His actual championship finishing positions aren't that impressive. Fourth in British F3 and sixth in F3 Euro Series, but you look at the people he was racing against. In British F3 he was fourth behind Mike Conway, Oliver Jarvis and Bruno Senna, where he used his overtaking prowess to good effect. Can he pull that out now? Final lap of the race. Basseng knows it, goes defensive, covers the inside line. Berman sends it to the outside in the BMW. That might have just been enough for Marc Basseng. Berman may not be able to find another opportunity on this 5.1 kilometre circuit to get past the Mercedes in front of it. It's his direct championship rival. Brilliant stuff. These two battling hard over the race position and over the championship. Into turn 5, Basseng's going to only take the racing line if he's 100% sure he doesn't need to cover the inside. Berman gets a good run out of 6. And as a result, Basseng again will just cover the inside line so he doesn't get a late lunge from Berman. Look how close they are as they come through turn 8. Berman goes wide to get the double apex and the better run up through the Schumacher S's. They're going to be so close through here. Well driven actually from Marc Basseng through there. He pulls out 2 or 3 car lengths through the Schumacher S. Hans Reiter is praying for his car of Peter Cox to come through, because here he comes through turn 13 up towards 14 and 15 at the chicane for the final time. Stefan Rossina made a great start. It was all down to the pit stop for Reiter Engineering. They've had pace throughout this season. Peter Cox has set some blistering lap times. There's a spin at the final corner. That almost caught him out. But the checkered flag is there for Peter Cox to take the win in the qualifying race for Reiter Engineering. Second place for Laurence Vanthoor. Hans Reiter is delighted. And Marc Basseng holds on to third place and closes in by 1 point in the battle for the championship. It's now down to 6. Now we wait for the 101 car of Dominic Baumann. Because when he comes out of the final corner, here he comes. Dominic Baumann and Maximilian Buch are about to become the 2012 FIA GT3 European champions. taking the race victory for Heiko Gravity Charroux Racing. Michael Lyons doing a great job to finish in second place, which means that the team's battle will continue on. But there is Peter Cox. He and Stefan Rosina have done a great job. Hugs and applause everywhere on the Lamborghini pit wall. There is Stefan Rosina. Getting a congratulatory call already by the looks of things. But that is great to see the Lamborghini take away. Because as I say, Peter Cox and Darryl O'Young have had great pace all year. Darryl O'Young's not here this weekend, so Stefan Rosina joins Cox. And the pair of them have taken the win. The big loser today, Steph Dusseldorp and Fred Mankiewicz. A real, real shame for them. Because if they had won this race, or at least got some decent points and been in the hunt, they've had more pace this weekend than the BMWs and the Mercedes, so they will feel like it's an opportunity lost to close in at the top of the championship. They're only 20 points behind. But they're 20 points behind now with 58 points up for grabs. So it's still doable, but all of a sudden, when the safety car came out at the first lap of the race, it looked like they were definitely in the title fight. Now, all of a sudden, it's a long shot. They're dark horses now. So the pit lane will now become a lot busier, and the fans and teams will head down to the podium area. Here's a look at the race results. The Lamborghini Gallardo winning for the first time this year, the Ryder engineering car of Stefan Rosina and Peter Cox taking the victory. 2.5 seconds clear of the Audi R8 of Laurens Vanthoor and Stefan Artelli, but Cox certainly backed off over the last stage of that race. It was up as much as 5.5 seconds. Mark Basseng and Marcus Vinghog, they always manage to pull it out of the bag, don't they? Third place after struggling to make it through to Q3 in qualifying. Berman and Bartels in fourth. Demoustier, good drive from him. Very impressed with Grégoire Demoustier today. He and Alvaro Parent finish in fifth. Pastorelli and Jaeger in sixth. Jarvis and Stippler. Only 1.8 seconds off the back of that Mercedes in the end. Belander and Salaquada, again, what might have been for them. Lauda and Mermanov ninth. Eden Castellacci 10th. Lariche and Groppi in 11th. And Jeroen Bleekemolen ending his race on the very first lap in the barriers on the exit of the Tuna Fest, which is a real shame for Bleekemolen and a shame for Reiter. But as Hans Reiter said, they've had an up and down season, and they had a very up and down qualifying race as well. Looking forward to seeing Peter Cox's reaction. Stefan Rosina thanking Peter Cox for bringing it home. Great stuff. And the Ryder Engineering squad can take their first win of the season. It's amazing to think that they're in sixth place in the championship after taking a third place in the opening race of the season, the qualifying race in Nagaro. They were in third position, Peter Cox and Darryl O'Young. That was Thomas Enger and Albert von Turner Taxis, wasn't it? It took that, but in that race, Peter Cox got the fastest lap of the race. Laurens Vanthoor, good drive from him to second place. And third place for Mark Basseng. Let's hear now from our race winners, Peter Cox and Stefan Rosina are with Hayley.
Peter, congratulations on a tremendous performance.
Yeah, it worked fantastically for us for once. You know, the guys worked so hard on the pit stop all year, and they always were fast, but always when it came to the pinnacle one, it never worked out for us, especially for my car then. And now everything worked fine, and I owe a lot also to Stefan, because he did a fantastic job and he made it possible that I could win this race today.
And Stefan, front row start for you tomorrow. Can you turn it into another win?
Well, let's see. I mean, I think we have to celebrate today, and then everything is possible, and we will try our best.
Thank you, guys.
Yeah, that's true. Qualifying race victory is by no means out of their reach. By no means at all. There is Marc Basseng. He congratulates Peter Cox. I think Mark's going to be pretty happy with the third place finish. And for the first time this weekend, I spoke to Marc Basseng on Friday, and he was fairly happy with how things had gone. And now they finished third in the qualifying race. So let's hear now from Stefano Telli and Laurence Vanthoor, second place in the qualifying race.
Congratulations, Laurence. What a good result for the team.
Yeah, it's a nice result. We started P2, finished P2, so nothing to blame about. Of course, we're leading at the moment, so it's always a little disappointing if you had a thing in hand, but I think we did the best we can, and yesterday we never thought that we would be here, so I think we can be happy.
Stefan, was there any issues with the pit stop, or were they just quicker?
No, we actually came with a little lead, which was not enough to go out. We know that we always lose a bit of time in pit stop, you know. It's due to the matter, it's nothing to do with the Audi or with the guys from WRT. They did an extremely good job, but these 4 seconds are counting, and at the end we are only 2 seconds behind. So I think we were not having enough laps to make a gap with the Lamborghini, but they deserve the win. I mean, they did a good job, and we were for sure with the Lamborghini the fastest car on the track today. So P2 at the start, P2 at the end, it's okay. I was happy with the lead, but I have to say that Lorenz did most of the job, you know.
Thank you, guys.
It's true. Ortelli was only in the car for... Well, he was in the car for a long time, but he was only probably racing for about 10 minutes or so before he came in to hand over to Laurence Vanthoor. There's Hans Reiter on the right-hand side. Absolutely chuffed to pieces. It's been an up-and-down season for them. They missed Moscow, unfortunately. You may remember the Lamborghinis were absent from Russia because of the large crash that Albert von Turn and Taxis had in Slovakia. They didn't have time to rebuild the car and refettle it and get it out in time for Moscow, but what a comeback it has been. So, Marc Basseng and Marcus Vingelhoek managed to hold on to that third place to close in the championship lead by a point.
Congratulations, guys. Marc, you had quite the challenge on your hands to hold on to that place.
Yeah, definitely. The car got hit at the start, so the exhaust was loose, and so I had not the full power, and the tires went a bit down. But I mean, I was catching up quick, but then behind me, it's like always to get close, okay, but to overtake is sometimes difficult. But it was hard and tough, and I'm happy that we gained 1 point.
And Marcus, what was it that the Mercedes was able to perform in qualifying and not in the qualifying session?
Yeah, in qualifying we were struggling, I have to say, but now in the race, car was feeling quite okay, I would say. Also, Marc was really strong at the end, and I think we absolutely can be happy with P3. It's a good result for today and a good start position for tomorrow, so I'm looking forward for it.
Thank you.
It will be Marc Basseng to start the championship race tomorrow. Here's how the championship standings look then. 5 points between first and second. Düsseldorf and Makovicki have dropped off a little bit, losing out a number of points to the championship leaders. Now 20 points behind after conceding 3 today. Ortelli and Vanthoor pick up another chunk of points. Jaeger and Pastorelli in 5th. Oliver Jarvis and Frank Stipler in 6th. And no real change as far as 4th, 5th and 6th are concerned. No change in the order of all the top 6. But the gap at the top has come down by a point, which is could be crucial come Donington Park. So that's how it looks in the drivers' standings. Team standings-wise, it was another good weekend for Al Inkle. Oh, sorry, another good race for Al Inkle. With Thomas Jaeger and Nicky Pastorelli picking up a decent haul of points as well. So they move up to 212 points ahead of the 176 of Vita Fuan, who needs to be careful because a strong finish tomorrow from Belgian Audi Club, and they'll be up into second place in the team's championship. So there's the Nürburgring Castle up on the hill overlooking the circuit. And so a exciting qualifying race here for GT1. As far as GT3 were concerned, it was a commanding victory for the 101 Heiko Gravity-Chirouz pairing of Maximilian Buch and Dominic Baumann. They had a very strong performance indeed, and we're going to see their podium presentation in a minute, because Buch and Baumann are now the 2012 FIA GT3 European Championship champions. The drivers' champions anyway. The team's championship still to be decided between Heiko Gravity Cheroux and AF Corsa. Heiko Gravity Cheroux having a better day of it today, but AF Corsa was 6 points ahead coming into the weekend, so it's going to be very close between the pair of them. No rain today, which was good. It did seem to threaten at times, but I can even see quite a decent amount of blue sky out there now over the Nürburgring, which is excellent stuff. And there are the champions, presumably in their specially made-up T-shirts, Dominic Baumann and Maximilian Buch, Michael Lyons and Stefano Guy. Second place for them in the race. And then in third place, the Heiko Gravity Cheroux, second pair of Max Nilsson and Mika Vähämäki. Yanis, the representative of Heiko Gravity Cheroux. And as a result, we will have the Czech Republic national anthem. So, the win for Baumann and Buch, that's the only thing that's been decided today. Second place in the championship still up for grabs. Gaetano Adagna Perez and Giuseppe Ciro were out of the running early on today, but still could be Harry Prochek and David Mengsdorf taking second place, and also the team's championship yet to be decided as well. That will all be decided tomorrow afternoon as part of the championship race. And there's the third place trophies. Alain de Melleraz, the Blancpain vice president, handing out the trophies. Stefano Guy and Michael Lyons taking their second place trophies from Errol Sander. And the race winning trophies for Maximilian Buch and Dominic Baumann. So the whistle's blowing, you can see, because they've just got to be careful in the pit lane, because some of the Blancpain Lamborghini Super Trofeo cars are coming into the pit lane. But the two championship winners will receive their actual championship trophy tomorrow. And as a result, they only get their winners' trophies today, but I'm sure they'll be more than happy with that. And now the champagne is sprayed for the 2012 FIA GT3 European champions. Well, they want a picture first. It was almost time for the champagne. And there are the top three teams from this race. Trophies aloft. That is Vyacheslav Maiev from the Russian Bears Motorsport on the right-hand side. He's the top-finishing bronze driver. Now the champagne for the 2012 FIA GT3 European champions. Great stuff from Baumann and Buch. Impressive performance throughout this season. Two youngsters with an impressive performance and a promising future in GT racing. Will we see them racing in the GT Sprint Series next year? Let us hope so, because they have been two very impressive young men. Mika Vähämäki and Max Nilsson as well have done a good job for Heiko, but It's all about Dominic Baumann and Maximilian Buch. Stefano Guy on the left-hand side, you can see, pretty happy with how his race has progressed, ending up there in second position. And that's a big swig of champagne, isn't it, for such a young man. And there's a look at the final championship standings as far as first place is concerned. It's still up for grabs, as I say, with second place. Guy and Lyons doing a good job to edge themselves clear of David Mengsdorf and Harry Prochick. But that could still go either way. It could, in theory, go to Gaetano Wadagna Perez and Giuseppe Ciro. They're still in the hunt for second place, but it would take quite a turnaround for that to happen tomorrow during the race. Niamarim and Cesar Campanico, unfortunately not here this weekend after their excellent victory in Moscow last time. Max Nielsen and Mika Vähämäki, after such strong pace, unable to turn that into points. Let's hear then from our 2012 FIA GT3 European champions. Dominic Baumann and Maximilian Buch are on the podium, covered in champagne, with Hayley Coxon.
Congratulations, guys. You are the 2012 champions. Dominic, how does it feel?
Yeah, it's absolutely great. We were 36 points in front of the others, so it was the right comfortable for us, but at the end, with a win, it's absolutely great.
Tell us about the T-shirts. Who's responsible for having these made?
Sorry?
Who's responsible for having these made?
It's the team, it's everyone, yeah. The team made that, it was a present for us, and yeah, that's right what I wanted, yeah.
Perfect. And Max, now you have one more race. Yeah. How are you going to approach that now that you're champions?
I think we're doing our best. Say, okay, now we have 15 seconds, but we don't care. We tried to win, tried to give the maximum again to have another victory, so... But I think tonight we will celebrate a bit.
Congratulations, guys. Thank you.
Brilliant performance from Buch and Baumann. They started off their season with a third and first place in the opening weekend in Nagaro. Difficult weekend in Zolder and the opening race in Navarra, but they won the second race in Navarra and then the first race in the Algarve, and a strong weekend. Last time out in Moscow gave them the upper hand in the championship, and that's what managed to pull them through. So now let's hear from Michael Lyons and Stefano Guy. They're on the podium with Hayley.
Congratulations, guys. Second place. What a race it was for you as well.
Yeah, it was a really good race. I thought for a little while we had the race with the Mercedes, but the first couple of laps I was really quick, and then it just eked away. At the end, I don't know if he was playing with us or maybe the championship gave him some nerves or something, but we closed right up. But it's great to be back on the podium. It feels like forever since we were here, and I think this is pretty close to cementing our second place in the championship, so it's good race all the way.
Stefano, your thoughts going into race two tomorrow?
Yes, I hope, and this fantastic race. I did a fantastic start at corner four. I was P1. After that, BMW of GT1 pushed me on the wrong line, and the other two cars overtake me. And after the restart of the safety car, I was P3, and I gave the car to Michael, P3. Michael did a fantastic job from P3 to P2 for the Lambo. I have a problem, some problem. Now we are second in the championship. I hope that tomorrow, at the end of the race, we are always second in championship.
Thank you.
Michael Lyons is right. It is forever since they've been on the podium. Back at the first race in Navarra, all the way back in that May, I think Navarra was. So it was a reasonable amount of time ago that Stefano Guy and Michael Lyons climbed onto the GT3 podium. And now let's hear from the teammates of the champions. It's Mika Vähämäki and Max Nielsen. How did their race go? They're with Hayley.
Congratulations, Mika. Another podium finish for you. Now, tomorrow, the aim is a team championship.
Yeah, for sure. We are trying to get as much points for the team as we can. And I think it's looking good now because 150 Ferrari crashed or something, so he didn't get any points. So looking good.
certainly is looking strong for you tomorrow, Max. Do you think you'll be able to take the title with you?
Yeah, I think so. I must believe in it, otherwise we cannot do it. But I think we can do it.
Thank you.
So there are our third place finishers from today. And they had a strong performance today to pick up another podium this season. They've only had one win this season, Vähämäki and Nielsen, at the first race in Navarra, that same race where Lyons and Guy were on the podium. But they do get involved in a lot of scraps. I think that's been their problem this season, Mika Vähämäki and Max Nielsen. They just end up getting involved in spins or crashes or something or another. They've had a puncture, didn't they, at the final corner in Portimao, which gave us some spectacular footage. But in general, it's been the season of Dominic Baumann and Maximilian Buch. Two very, very impressive young drivers. Baumann, 19 years old, from Austria. And Maximilian Buch winning the championship at his home race. He's from Rheinbeck in Germany, 19 years old as well. So watch out for those two in the future in GT racing. So let's have a look back at this qualifying race. It was a good start from the McLaren. Fred McAvicky holding the lead. Sorry, Steph Dusseldorf, it wasn't the wheel, holding the lead down into the first corner. All very busy behind, but in general, the order remained the same. Great onboard shots we had from Marcus Vingelhoek's car as he managed to... Well, he made contact with his teammate there. We didn't spot that on the live broadcast. But then we had the spin and the accident for Jeroen Bleekemolen on the exit of the Schumacher S. That brought out the safety car for an unfortunately long period of time. When it came in, though, Steph Dusseldorf ran into problems. We thought initially it was a puncture, but the team boss said it was some kind of wishbone or suspension failure. That put Audis into first and second place, with the Lamborghini of Stefan Rossina in third position. There were good battles throughout the order, but then the pit stop window came. The 37 Mercedes got out in front of Jelmer Berman, so Nicky Pastorelli would have a big defending job to do. Michael Bartels disappointed that Vita for One couldn't get their car out quickly enough. Oliver Jarvis and Frank Stippler lost out in the pits, not really because of that stumble, more because of a rear left wheel nut that was struggling to go on. 38 car came into the pits as well, but here's where Nicky Pastorelli's defending began, desperately trying to keep Jelmer Berman behind, as much for position as for the team's championship as well. There was the crucial point in the race. Peter Cox in the Lamborghini getting out in front of Laurens Vanthoor in the Audi, managing to jump him at the pit stops. And Peter Cox immediately put the hammer down and pulled away in the lead of the race, much to his teammate Stefan Rossina's delight. Alvaro Parent came out, smoky rear tyres, and he couldn't quite hold on to the lead of the race. Peter Cox it was who moved into the lead and then gradually pulled away. Demoustier was soon under pressure from the cars behind him, and on the outlap he got it wrong at turn four. That allowed Vanthoor and Basseng to come through on the run down into turn five. Those two would have a little battle for the rest of the race, but in the end, Vanthoor would begin to pull away. Demoustier then under pressure from the Mercedes of Nicky Pastorelli behind, but in the end it was Jelmer Berman who made the move on Nicky Pastorelli. Going down into the hairpin, he sent one up the inside to move up into fifth position, and his sights were then set on Grégoire Demoustier in the McLaren. Was he going to be able to close in quickly enough? He was indeed, got up the inside into the final corner. Again, much to the BMW's team delight, though he couldn't quite get past the race leader, the third place man, Marc Basseng. Try as he might, he got very, very close, but Basseng closes in by 1 point on Berman and Bartels at the top of the Drivers' Championship. Hans Reiter was praying for his driver, Peter Cox, and Peter Cox duly delivered with a win in the qualifying race, and that will give them pole position for tomorrow's championship race. You can join us for it at 12:30 local time. It's going to be a very, very interesting event, no doubt about that. Can Stefan Rossina and the Lamborghini take their first championship race win of the season? We also had the GT3 champions, Maximilian Buch and Dominic Baumann, doing a great job to take the 2012 championship. But Peter Cox and Stefan Rossina will start the championship race from pole position tomorrow. Baumann and Buch win FIA GT3. But join us tomorrow for the championship race at 12:30 local time. From myself, Jack Nichols, and Hayley Coxon, we'll see you tomorrow.